This is the motto of the show, Hour of the Truth. Rome never changes. They used to call us heretics and sent the Inquisition to kill us. Today they call us terrorists and send on their crusades. Times and methods may have changed, but the goal still stays the same. Extirpate the remnant of the true Word of God, Bible-believing people who uphold the truth in Jesus Christ's name.
Suffering at the hands of Rome, 'cause they believed in Christ alone. They died through Europe, especially Spain, for they saw all but Christ is vain. He suffered by his death for men, to save them from their awful sin. 600 years of martyred saints that history cannot erase. With iron heel and iron hand, the Roman popes rule the land. Those ignorant of history may be swept into apostasy. We won't be lulled by Rome's sweet lie, with 50 million reasons why. Salvation is by faith alone, in Christ alone, by grace alone. A sovereign God give faith to man. Salvation's in the Maker's hand. This gospel offends Rome today. They offer up another way, a counterfeit, a compromise. Beware the ancient papal lie, with such a cloud of witnesses who by grace died in their Lord. Recall their memory to say, by the same faith we live today.
Hello and welcome to a new video from Joggler 66, Hour of the Truth. It is my pleasure to introduce to you today my guest of today, which is Tom Fress, who you of course know already from the numerous uploads that have been done on the different channels of mine, Inquisition Update, and of course I hope that you know him from his work that he does now at this moment and that he has done for the last more than eight years in the meantime, on First Amendment Radio. And I asked Tom a little time ago when I got sent 8 different books by Brother Brett Norman, who cannot join us tonight because he's busy working in this system that we need to pay our daily debts, you know, that we have in this Antichrist system. So he couldn't join us today, but hopefully he will join us in the future. But Tom agreed to come and sit down with me and read the book, The Origin of Futurism and Preterism. That is one of the 8 books, or actually it's a little booklet, it's about 68 pages only, which Brett sent to me a few weeks ago together with other books. And this really caught my attention in the beginning, not only because it is so short, but because actually in this book it seemed at first glance everything is written that Tom always taught. All the years Tom was teaching the wrong teaching of the Roman Catholic Church, of the unfulfillment of Daniel's 70th week. Tom was teaching all the years, and still is teaching all the years, the deception that the futurist lie will lead us all to, with ecumenism. That is kind of the high point of the futurist agenda, let us say, because with the ecumenical movement, they really got Protestantism to capitulate. But the book is called The Origin of Futurism and Preterism, and is written by Charles A. Jennings, who also authored another book, which is mentioned on page 46 in this book, and we will come to later. And I ordered that a few days ago, and I just received it. And that book is called The Book of Revelation from an Israelite and Historicist Interpretation. And I think it will be very interesting to maybe get a read on that book too. But we will see that in the future. For now, this broadcast is about the first part of The Origin of Futurism and Preterism. And I welcome to the table my dear brother in Christ from the United States of America, Tom Fress from Inquisition Update. How are you, brother?
Oh, I'm fine, and I'm very happy to be here with you today and with your listeners and to discuss this little booklet, The Origin of Futurism and Preterism. I would correct one point, though. I believe this particular book is authored by Paul Owen. I'm not particularly familiar with him.
Well, that's the first part, Tom.
Okay,
you know,
there is a second part?
The first part is about preterism, the second is about futurism, and this first part was written by Paul Owen, as you stated. That's correct.
Yeah.
And the futurist part was written by Jennings.
Okay, so this is two books together then.
Yeah.
I missed that. Okay, that's my error. Anyway, before we begin, I would like to just tell your listeners that though we have found common ground in what is taught in this little booklet, actually, which is two parts, The Origin of Futurism and Preterism, and also The Tragic Aftermath of Futurism, it comes to us from a ministry that calls itself Truth in History Ministries, and the Bible Educator Ministry, and it's got a P.O. box in Owosso, Oklahoma. Now, I'm not familiar with this ministry, and I would just remind the listeners and caution the listeners that just because we find common ground in these little booklets does not make us a blanket endorsement of this particular ministry, which I am completely unfamiliar with. So, this booklet was sent to me, and I read it in its entire. It's a good work, and it's worthy of plenty of discussion and further research by the listeners. And it's my hope to share this truth with your listeners without endorsing the ministry that provides it, because it would take too much effort and time to investigate everything else that this particular ministry promotes. So with that disclaimer, we'll continue then as Yerk sees fit to continue with this reading and discussion.
Well, Tom, first and foremost, I want to say I absolutely agree about what you said about this publishing ministry in Oklahoma. And that is also the reason why when we take onto us to read and discuss books like this or booklets like this, that we are not just reading these books verbatim, but we are also discussing them. We give also our opinion, our view of what is written in this book to the discernment of the listener or the viewer of the video. And these comments actually make this more than just a book reading. A book reading would be an endorsement, I agree. But a book reading and discussion would absolutely not. And you know, there are there are works out there that you can find where you absolutely, even though the title and everything in history you agree with, here and there are a little few sentences that you do not agree with.
Yeah.
And it's funny that you mentioned that, because just today I was preparing the next reading of the book that I'm reading for the moment, that is called The History of the Inquisition. And I was preparing the next reading, because in the beginning of that page where I was reading, it was such a small print, and I couldn't even almost read the letters very fine, so that I had to prepare this reading a little bit, because normally I don't even prepare what I read here. But in that book, all of a sudden appeared something in a sentence that I said, I do not agree with that. And I looked that up in the meantime that I'm talking to you here, and I can read that to you, and you will see why I do not agree with it, even though this is a book from 1692, written by a Protestant, a Dutch Protestant, on the history of the Inquisition. The sentence reads, And the term of this union, which he lays down, is the acknowledgement of one Catholic Church, one Spirit, one Lord, and Mediator, and one God, even the Father of all, who is above all, through all, and in all. Unquote. Mm-hmm. That mentioning in this book of one Catholic Church is something that I absolutely do not agree. And the author, Philip van Limborch, who wrote this book, is not the only one, or even in this case, it's still the introduction, so that is the translator, Samuel Chandler, who wrote this, is something that I do not agree with. And I know that I am on the same term with you on that, Tom, because you told me that when I was going to read Romanism by Lorraine Bettner. Mm-hmm. And Lorraine Bettner does the same thing. He equivocates, if that's the right term, the Church of Christ, if used properly, is if used in the way that it is meant in the Bible, as a Catholic Church. Mm-hmm. And I do not agree on that term.
No, I do not either.
And you do not either. I know that. And that's why I say, well, listen, I read this book, History of the Inquisition, which is a wonderful book. But here and there you come into one sentence or a few words and then you say, I cannot agree with that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and this is one of these cases, and we probably will also endeavor a case or two like this in the book reading of The Origin of Futurism and Preterism. Mm-hmm. And that's why I think it is very important to make sure to our listeners that they understand that we never ever endorse the completion of any one book. And that's why we are not only reading, but also discussing it. Because here and there, everybody makes a mistake. Even authors make mistakes or use expressions that are not in line with biblical teaching.
That's right.
And to you, Tom, and to me, that is the most important point, that the things are in line with the Bible. That's right. They have to be in line not with any Bible, but they have to be in line with the King James Version, the 1611 authorized version of the Bible, in my, Jörg's, and Tom's opinion, the only true, inerrant, preserved Word of God in our times today.
I agree.
Now, on the inside of this little booklet, where there's this mentioning of the P.O. Box 808 Oklahoma Ministry, it says also, all scriptures are taken from the King James Version of the Bible. So that's already one point that I say I like this book, because then we don't always have to check, but even though that is sometimes advisable, to cross-check when there are references made to the Bible, if they are really taken word by word, because you have had an experience with reading the book The Foundations Under Attack that you are reading for the moment on Inquisition Update, that even in books like this, when they say this is the the KJV, they do not always cite the complete KJV. Is that right?
That's correct.
Maybe you want to talk a few minutes about that and tell our listeners what you've experienced by reading that book, The Foundations Under Attack, what the point of arousement, however you can say that, was to you.
Well, there was a passage of the King James Version that was quoted incorrectly in that book, and it is the passage that goes like this: He who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. And that's what is said in the authorized King James Version of the Bible, the 1611 King James Version. He who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. Paul was speaking to his Thessalonian congregation, writing to them, and he plainly told them, he who is now restraining will restrain until he be taken out of the way. He who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. So who was restraining the rise of Antichrist at the time of Paul? Well, it was the Roman Caesars. The pagan Roman Empire was still in power, and it was soon to be replaced by the quote-unquote Holy Roman Empire under the papacy. And the papacy could not come to power until the Caesars were taken out of the way. And Paul was literally, without being perfectly explicit, Because had he been perfectly explicit in saying that the Roman Empire is about to crumble, and then in its place will rise the man of sin, the son of perdition, the Antichrist, he would have been arrested for sedition.
He would have been taken out of the way.
He would have been taken out of the way, and so would the Thessalonians who had received his letter. Paul was literally predicting the fall of the Roman Empire. And he was predicting, prophesying the immediate rise of the Antichrist, the man of sin. And so if you take out of the King James Bible the word now and just leave it, he who restrains will restrain until he's taken out of the way, it leaves you clueless as to who Paul is talking about.
Mm-hmm. Just for our listeners to make sure, if you have the book maybe in front of you, maybe some listeners do, The Foundations Under Attack, The Roots of Apostasy by Michael Desemlian on page 86 is one of the, because it is it appears in the book two or three times, the same mistake. On page 86 it is to be found, and it is a quote from 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 7. And the King James, as they write it in this book, reads, "For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who letteth will let until he be taken out of the way." And the "he" is written in small letters. Now, in comparison, the author puts here the New King James Version. "For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way." And the "he" is capitalized. And my point always was, first of all, of course, I agree with Tom, you have to put the "now" in there, because otherwise that doesn't make any sense. But what the author is only speaking about is that the "he" in capital letters in the New King James Version, because it is capitalized, refers to the Holy Spirit. While, of course, in the King James Version, where the "he" is written in small letters, it does not. But there, of course, the "now" is left out of the print in this book. And Tom even contacted Michael Desemlian before he went to work on Inquisition Update to read and discuss this book. And he said that he was even as surprised as Tom to understand that this "now" was not in there. But then I still ask myself, why didn't he go into the explanation of the difference, why did he only make the point of the "he"? But that's another discussion. And I don't even want to go too far away from the subject that we came together here, because we are almost 20 minutes in and we haven't even started the reading. But I think it is quite interesting that Tom elaborates a little bit on that point, because you have to see, or you have to understand, it is not because you read a quote of the Bible in some book that it is the right quotation. You should always have your Bible on the side and check the quotations if they are absolutely right, because otherwise you can fall into a trap. But please, Tom, continue a little bit on your explanation.
Well, I would conclude with this. The whole purpose for the perversions of the King James Bible, in number one, taking out the word "now," leaves the reader impossible to figure out who the restrainer is. If the word "now" is included, it's obvious who the restrainer is. It's the Roman power. It's the Caesars. And if one is unable to determine positively from what Paul said who is restraining the rise of the mystery of iniquity, then it's impossible to determine from what Paul says what that mystery of iniquity is. Mm-hmm. And it's the papacy. And it was immediately replaced the Caesars when the old Roman Empire crumbled. And so if the Bible perverters can remove just one word and leave the reader clueless as to who Paul was talking about, he also leaves the reader clueless about who the mystery of iniquity is.
Yep.
So, and then also the other ridiculous assertion from the Bible perverters is that they capitalize the word he who now restrains, leaving us to believe that it's in reference to the Holy Spirit. But we know the Holy Spirit will never be taken out of the world. Okay?
No, the Holy Spirit stays with us until Jesus Christ returns.
That's right.
That's
the
what
Holy
he promised.
This is God's creation. And to say that the Holy Spirit would be taken out of the world is absurd on its face.
Yeah.
And what do both of these things accomplish? That's the question. What do both of these things accomplish?
Insecurity.
It hides from us the identity of who Paul was speaking.
Yeah, and it just sows insecurity and how do you say that?
Nope.
A missing of trust of us into the Bible when these things come out, you know?
Listen, God doesn't speak. God spoke plainly through Paul. The purpose was to identify to the Thessalonian believers and to all the other believers who this man of sin would be.
Mm-hmm.
God wants us to know who the man of sin is as much as he wants us to know who his son is. And it's the papacy that Paul was describing that would replace the Caesars when they were taken out of the way. And this is the belief of all early Christians, that power that would replace the Caesars once they were taken out of the way would be that man of sin, the mystery of iniquity, the son of perdition, the Antichrist of the Bible. And history leaves no question about it either.
No.
That power that replaced the Caesars was the papacy. And Paul wanted his believers to know who this Antichrist, who this deceiver, who this one that would persecute the saints would be, just as much as he wanted them to know who Jesus was, their friend, their deliverer, their propitiation for their sins.
Mm.
Paul spoke in clandestine terms in writing, but when he was with the Thessalonians face to face, he made no bones about who this restrainer was, nor who this man of sin would be.
Absolutely. And we can also confirm that by Henry Gretton Guinness's book, Romanism and the Reformation, on page 195, you will find a prayer that the Christians of the early church, of the first church, actually prayed to keep the Caesar in power, because they knew that when the Caesar would be taken out of the way, a much more severe persecution would be starting. The Antichrist would show up in the world.
Yeah.
But sorry to interrupt you here, Tom. I think we are almost doing another broadcast. But this is so interesting and so important. It cannot be told often enough. But I think that we should go to start the reading of the book.
What we're going to find, Jörg, mm-hmm. what we're going to find is that the origins of futurism and preterism have in themselves the same objective as did the perverters of Scripture who removed the word now from Paul's dissertation.
To take the spotlight of the papacy
as
the Antichrist.
To take the onus of Antichrist away from the papacy.
Absolutely.
To leave the identity of the Antichrist unknown, or at least questionable.
Yeah.
And that's what futurism does, and that's what preterism does. They're all cut from the same pile of manure, if you'll pardon my expression.
Absolutely.
Okay.
I pardon your expression completely. You know, the interesting point is that when you read through preterism, which we will start in a few minutes, and then you read about futurism, which we will start probably on another broadcast, because this booklet is too thick to do this in one or even two broadcasts probably, you will understand that preterism and futurism are mutually exclusive. It can whether be the one or the other. And
sure.
The idea of us reading and discussing this book is to show you that it's neither.
Right.
It's neither preterism nor futurism that is right, but it is historicism.
That's correct.
And we will make our job to turn people to historicism. The history is right. And do you know why the history is right, dear listener? because Bible prophecy, the God, the Word of God, is history written in advance. And the Word of God never fails. So history and historicism is the only way. And we will prove that and show that by reading and discussing this book, The Origin of Futurism and Preterism, starting with the explanation of preterism, a part in the book, because it is in two parts. One deals with preterism that we start with now, and the other is about futurism. And this first part of preterism was written by Paul Owen. And I want to read to you from the backside of the book to give you a little idea who he was. Paul Owen, it says, was born 1916 in a farming community of southern Illinois. He was raised in the Baptist church, and you have some experience with Baptist churches over there, Tom, I guess?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
By dedicated Christian parents. The family, your parents were Pentecostal, if I'm right, right?
Yes, that's correct.
And later you came over to a Baptist church, if I'm not mistaken.
And they both taught the same error,
and you had a wonderful charismatic experience in one of the Baptist churches, right? And then you saw, and then you saw a Roman Catholic priest in white garments in the back of the church. Yeah, I know that because I just listened to your archives of First Amendment Radio of 2009, and you were speaking about that. So that's fresh in my memory. Okay, so the family moved to Burbank, CA. That's California.
Yes.
In 1923. Soon afterward, Paul accepted Jesus Christ as his personal savior at 8 years old in a Sunday school class. Yeah. If you are a real Christian, there is no Sunday school. There should be a Saturday, a Sabbath school. Right. Now, in California, he received his education, raised his family, and began a secular career with the United States Post Office. Now comes a very interesting sentence, if you are a Bible-believing Christian. He willingly served his country for 4 years in military service during World War II. You cannot be a Bible-believing Christian and serve the Antichrist's army with a carnal sword and kill other people. Paul Owen has spent his life as a follower of Jesus Christ and a student of the Scriptures. In the 1940s, the Holy Spirit placed within him a deep desire to have an in-depth understanding of God's Word. Ever since then, his life's passion has been to live a life for the glory of his Savior, Jesus Christ, and the furtherance of God's kingdom. I will continue with reading the foreword of the book The Origin of Futurism and Preterism. Maybe I will continue right away if Tom doesn't have any remarks up to here.
No, go ahead.
Okay. So the foreword of the book, The Origin of Futurism and Preterism. This is written by Paul Owen. A few years ago, I wrote a small booklet titled An Unchangeable Framework and a Firm Foundation that included a chapter dealing with preterism and futurism. This booklet amplifies somewhat those brief comments relating to preterism and presents an overview of it for your study. I consider this topic of great importance, and trust this small work will arouse your interest enough to investigate carefully all sides of this issue. The information contained herein is a brief introduction to the origin of the futurist and preterist view of prophecy. It concerns itself with the interpretation and fulfillment of prophecy, and not with the teaching of the fundamentals of the faith. The term fundamentals of the faith can be condensed to the confession, Jesus Christ is Lord. Hopefully, all who read these pages, whatever their persuasion of prophecy, would say, Amen, to Jesus Christ is Lord. It should be noted that this author, Paul Owen, does not hold to preterism or futurism, but yields himself to the historicist viewpoint. Part 1. The Origin of Futurism and Preterism. And Tom, you know the rules. As soon as you want to make one comment, you just say comment and I will interrupt my reading. Okay?
All right.
So feel free anytime you want to come in. This booklet falls naturally into three sections. The first section is the most important because it addresses the origin of both the futurist and preterist views of prophecy. Section 2 will show the progression of the development of preterism from the period of the early church down through the Reformation. While there are divisions among preterists as to certain of their dogmas, most hold to the belief that Christ's second coming has already occurred, that all of prophecy has been fulfilled, and that we are now in the kingdom of Christ, the kingdom of heaven. This section will provide numerous Bible passages that offer sufficient biblical support for the view that the second coming of Christ, as foretold in Scripture, has not yet occurred. The third section will submit an Old Testament prophecy that puts to rest the preterist's theory of the early fulfillment of all prophecy. It will conclude with two examples of the preterist's misunderstanding or misapplication of Scripture. The history of futurism and preterism should cause any thinking Christian flirting with either to take a serious, in-depth look at both schools of prophecy and Scripture. And I cannot emphasize this little sentence more than enough. I cannot emphasize this enough. We, as Bible-believing Christians, have to take everything that the Scripture reveals to us from Scripture and not from the teachings of man. Futurism and preterism, as you will learn, are teachings that are quote-unquote Bible-based. They are Bible-based interpretations from men. That both men are actually also Jesuits, that is for an absolutely another broadcast. But the point is, as this last sentence says, the history of futurism and preterism should cause any thinking Christian, please think for once, flirting with either preterism or futurism, to take a serious in-depth look at both schools of prophecy and Scripture. And Scripture, the sentence ends. Just take a look at Scripture and you will see that Scripture does not support either preterist nor futurist views. But we are going to define a few of the terms that are coming up right now after Tom has made a little comment.
What we're about to delve into is the two lies that are told in the churches all over the world. And to prove their error, that preterism, the school of interpretation of Bible prophecy called preterism, is a lie, and that futurism, an alternate school of interpretation of Bible prophecy, is also a lie, and a common agenda between the two. Preterism, which suggests that most of Bible prophecy has been fulfilled long ago, and futurism, that school of interpretation that suggests that Bible prophecy won't be fulfilled until just 7 years before Christ returns, they both have a common agenda. And what is that agenda? To protect and to preserve and to keep secret the identity of the biblical Antichrist, the man of sin, the son of perdition. It's the same mentality, the same school of deception that we just talked about that was used in Michael DeSemlian's book in removing the word now from the passage of 2 Thessalonians 2, verse 7. If you remove the word now from that passage, you have no idea who Paul's speaking of, who is restraining the rise of Antichrist, and therefore you cannot know who the Antichrist is. Likewise, preterism disguises the identity of the Antichrist as the papacy, and futurism obscures the identity of the Antichrist as the papacy. Every one of these deceptions that we've talked about positively leaves in doubt who the Antichrist is and exonerates the papacy. Now, the third and the only correct interpretation of Bible prophecy, the only school of Bible prophecy that was held by Christian believers from the first century to the present, is historicism. Historicism. The belief that Bible prophecy, as Yerk previously said, prophecy is simply the foretelling of history, and that history fulfills the prophecies, and that to see fulfillment of Bible prophecy, one has to look at history. And what does that reveal? What does history reveal? That the papacy is, was, and always will be the Antichrist, the restrainer that Paul talked about, the one who, the restrainer who prevented the rise of the Antichrist, who Paul talked about in 2 Thessalonians, the Roman Caesars, and that power that filled the power vacuum that was left when the Caesars were taken out of the way was the papacy. And the whole history of the papacy, now I know we could almost say that less than 1% of the listeners are familiar at all with the history of the papacy. It's just not a matter of discussion. But that the history of the papacy, which we are mostly all ignorant of, proves without a doubt that only the papacy qualifies to be that man of sin, the son of perdition, the one who deceived the whole world, the one who reigns over the kings of the earth, the presidents, the kings, the queens, the potentates, all over the world, and the one who persecutes the saints of Almighty God, can be none other than the papacy. There's not even another candidate for this description than the papacy. And that is only discovered through the historicist school of Bible interpretation, prophecy interpretation. Now, appropriately, the author is going to define for us what these terms mean, historicism, preterism, and futurism. And we need to watch and listen very carefully to these definitions, because we're going to be dealing with them throughout the section. All right. Back to you, Yerk.
Yes, so I will now define the prophetic schools for you, that we really understand the terms historicism, preterism, and futurism. For those who find the terms historicism, preterism, and futurism rather ambiguous, the definitions are herein supplied. First, we're going to explain what we understand of historicism. Historicism teaches that Jesus Christ's unveiling to the Apostle John, that comprises the book of Revelation, renders an ongoing history of the quote-unquote church, or quote-unquote called out ones, because that's what church stands for. From the time of John, as you know, that was written about 95 AD, until the second advent, means the second coming of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Okay, now let me comment here.
Please.
In case it slipped anybody, I want to say exactly what the author said in different terms. In the historicist school of Bible interpretation, the book of Revelation records the history of the entire church age. Okay? You've not been taught that in your churches, because you've either been taught preterism or you've been taught futurism. Both of them suggest, both of them, preterism and futurism, suggest that the book of Revelation skips over the entire church age. Preterism says that the book of Revelation records Bible prophecy that was fulfilled some 2,000 plus years ago. Okay, that's before the church age, right? Futurism says that the prophecies of the book of Revelation won't be fulfilled until just 7 years before Christ returns. That's jumping over the church age. What preterism and futurism suggest is something that is absurd on its face, that God completely omitted all record of the church age for 2,000 years. And isn't it coincidence that it was during that 2,000-year period, the church age, that the Antichrist, the papacy, ruled supreme over the kings of the earth, that he deceived the whole world, that he persecuted the saints, drunk with the blood of the saints and the martyrs of Jesus. He reigned over the kings of the earth. He burned Christians. He burned Bibles. The man of sin, the son of perdition, is literally skipped over by futurism. And it says, and preterism says, no, that all those prophecies were fulfilled before the church age. I can demonstrate to you immediately, right on its face, just common sense, without knowing the content of the rest of this book verifying what I'm just telling you, what should be obvious on its face to anyone who's even listening, that preterism is absurd. That the Bible doesn't record anything of the 2,000 years of church age. And futurism does the same ridiculous thing, claiming that the book of Revelation won't be fulfilled until just 7 years before Christ returns, completely skipping over the entire church age. Now, what makes common sense? We're called the bride of Christ, the body of Christ. 2,000 years of Bible reading, God-fearing, Bible-loving people sharing the gospel. And God went to sleep and didn't even mention our history, our 2,000-year history. It's absurd on its face. If you need but one argument to suggest that either that both preterism and futurism are absurd on their face, I just gave it to you. The book of Revelation, the marvelous revelation of Jesus Christ given to us by the Apostle John in 95 AD, told beforehand the trials and the tribulations and the persecutions and the apostasies of the church, his body, and identified who it would be that would persecute and deceive and murder his people. And it's the entire church age for 2,000 years. And only the historicist school of Bible interpretation acknowledges all 2,000 years of church age. So I've just given you already, before we even get to the meat and potatoes of this book, just how absurd futurism and preterism is. Back to you, Jörg.
Yeah, and let me make sure, dear listener, that we are speaking for those who believe. Because for those who believe, no proof is necessary, and for those who don't believe, no proof is even possible, said a certain Stuart Chase. But even people who believe have doubts. And why do they have doubts, Tom? Because they are fed with wrong Bibles, they are indoctrinated with wrong history, and they do not know where to turn anymore. And this ministry that I have on YouTube, on Hour of the Truth, and that you have with Inquisition Update on First Amendment Radio, is there to sustain people who believe, even though that no proof is necessary. We will show them the proof of the Bible, that everything they probably always have known gets confirmation of that.
Yes.
So historicism, I will repeat this little paragraph before I go into preterism, to sum it up in one short sentence, what Tom was so eloquently elaborating about. Historicism teaches that Jesus Christ's unveiling to the Apostle John, that comprises that that comprises the book of Revelation renders an ongoing history of the church or called out ones from the time of John until the second advent. Since that has not come yet, it is spanning a time of almost 2,000 years at the moment that we are in 2017, right now. Now, preterism, the author continues, generally attempts to place the fulfillment of all prophecy, meaning the whole book of Revelation, at the fall of Jerusalem in 70 AD, yet, and this is an interesting continuation of that sentence, some preterists look at fulfillment when pagan Rome fell in 410 AD. Now, let me ask you one thing before Tom comes in here with a comment, because I know that he's sitting on the top of his chair, wants to fall in. If even the preterist school in itself is divided, how can that be a teaching from God, who is not the author of confusion? When there are preterists who believe that all prophecy was fulfilled by the fall of Jerusalem in 70 AD, which Jesus Christ predicted in Matthew 24, or other preterists look at the fulfillment when pagan Rome fell in 410 AD, and we have a time span of 340 years that are uncounted for. But please, Tom, you want to make a comment, eh?
Yes. Preterism suggests that the book of Revelation is fulfilled either by 70 AD in the fall of Jerusalem by the Roman Prince Titus, the Roman 10th Legion, or the book of Revelation is fulfilled no later than 410 AD at the time of the fall of the pagan Roman Empire. So, what is the obvious conclusion from either one of these interpretations, divisions within preterism? It's simply this, that ever since either 70 AD or 410 AD, the Antichrist has been taken out of the way. And so, therefore, what has been the reality in the world since 410 AD is the literal kingdom of Christ. And who does that put at the head of this kingdom of Christ?
Oh, I know the answer. May I say?
Oh, go ahead, Yerk.
The Pope.
That's right.
The guy with the fish head.
That's
and with
right.
the funny with his funny clothes over there in Rome.
Yeah.
Who
so
goes...
they're suggesting that the one who reigneth over the kings of the earth was the Roman Caesars. The one who was drunk with the blood of the saints and the martyrs of Jesus was the Roman Caesars.
Yes, and now today we have a legitimate Vicarius Filii Dei.
Yeah. Now we have the Pope, the Holy Roman Empire, don't we? And this is the very basis of Rome's claim to the kingdom of heaven. They suggest, now let me explain something else that's elementary, that you're never going to hear about in your churches. Since the beginning of the Roman Catholic Church, there have always been people, at least the people who could read, who somehow got their hands on a Bible. And they read it for themselves as much as they could and sought God for understanding. And they came to the conclusion that the only possible candidate for the fulfillment of Bible prophecy regarding the Antichrist, the man of sin, the son of perdition, was none other than the head, the leader of the Roman Catholic Church, the popes. That's people within the Roman Catholic Church came to the same conclusion as did the Protestant reformers. All throughout the history of the Roman Catholic Church, the papacy has always had to deal with people inside the Roman Catholic Church, card-carrying Roman Catholics who came to the Protestant understanding of Scripture. That this the fulfillment of all these prophecies can be found in none other than the papacy. And so the papacy was continually throughout the church's history having to deal with dissent within the church by Roman Catholic Church members accusing the papacy of being the Antichrist. So the papacy had to come up with a way to shed the onus of Antichrist away from itself. And what they chose to do was to find alternative interpretations of Bible prophecy that put the onus of Antichrist onto someone else. So the Roman Catholic Church created centuries ago to deal with the dissent within the church, this preterist alternative view. And the priest would go to the so-called heretic who called the Pope the Antichrist and simply said, no, it's the Roman Caesars. You got it all wrong. The prophecies are fulfilled by the Roman Caesars. Remember how the Roman Caesars reigned over the kings of the earth? Remember how the Roman Caesars persecuted the saints in the Colosseum and fed them to lions and crucified them and burned them at the stake and on and on and on? That was the Antichrist was the Roman Caesars. And what we have today, now that the ancient Roman Empire has fallen, we now see Christianity as the religion of the new Roman Empire headed up by the Pope. It's a holy Roman Empire. You can't accuse the Pope of being the Antichrist when the prophecy seemed to be fulfilled in none other but the old pagan Roman Empire, Caesar's. Okay, so that silenced the dissent within the Roman Catholic Church of those card-carrying Roman Catholics who came to the Protestant conclusion that the Pope is the Antichrist. No, it was the Caesars. And that ended in 410 AD. What we have now is the kingdom of Christ under the Pope. That the papacy and the Roman Catholic Church are going to bring Christianity to the entire world. They're going to convert the whole world to Roman Catholicism. Okay? That's one way that the papacy shed the onus of Antichrist away from the papacy. There was another one. You see, preterism wasn't believed by everybody, all those who accused the papacy of being the Antichrist, and would not believe that the Caesars were. So the papacy had to deal with this continuing dissent within the Roman Catholic Church. The papacy is the Antichrist. And so they came up with the futurist interpretation of Bible prophecy. And so the Roman Catholics could believe either one or the other. It didn't matter which to the Pope, which one they believed, so long as they believed one or the other and exonerated the papacy. Futurism suggests that the Antichrist is not the papacy, but it is one man. One man that won't show his face in the world until the last 7 years before Christ returns. The Christian world, let's call it Christendom, will not have to deal with the Antichrist throughout the 2,000 years of Christian history, and he'll be just a parenthesis, a very brief parenthesis at the end of time, and he'll be destroyed, and then Christ will return. That's what futurism teaches. And futurism was created in the Roman Catholic Church centuries ago to stop dissent within the Roman Catholic Church. Now, for those who continued in the Roman Catholic Church to accuse the papacy, then the papacy offered a solution. If you won't believe in preterism and exonerate the papacy, and if you won't believe in futurism and exonerate the papacy, we'll create the Inquisition. And we'll either force you to recant through torture and confiscation of your goods, and we'll take your children, and we'll make you an enemy of the state and an enemy of the church and persecute you out of existence, or we'll just kill you. You got your choice. So most people either accepted the preterist view of Bible prophecy interpretation or the futurist view of Bible prophecy interpretation, but they couldn't hang on to historicism. They couldn't hang on to the belief that the papacy was the Antichrist because it just cost too much. Now, that almost perfectly silenced the dissent within the Roman Catholic Church. But in 1517 AD, there became a widespread resurgence of the belief that the papacy is, was, and always will be the Antichrist. That preterism is wrong, that futurism is wrong, the papacy is the Antichrist. And what happened in 1517? Well, prior to that, Bibles were beginning to be produced in mass quantities. And more people by then had learned how to read, and they read it for themselves, and they came to the same conclusion that the dissenters within the Roman Catholic Church came to. And not only a few, all of Europe began to move in that direction. It's the papacy. It's the papacy. And so Catholics began to flood out of the Roman Catholic Church, to leave the Roman Catholic Church in droves. They read the Bible for the first time in their life in their own language so that they could understand it, so that they could read it, and so that the Holy Spirit could witness the truth to them. They came to the unanimous conclusion. It's not preterism. It's not futurism. It's the papacy, the historical papacy. All throughout the so-called Holy Roman Empire, it's the papacy is the man of sin, the son of perdition, the Antichrist. So dissent became exponentially more powerful than it ever had been before. And so you have the Protestant Reformation, those who protested the Antichrist. They came out of the Roman Catholic Church in protest of the Antichrist, the papacy. And they suggested a reform of the church, of the Roman Catholic Church. And when they didn't get it, they simply divorced themselves completely from the Roman Catholic Church. That's the Protestant Reformation. Now, Rome had to consider how to deal with this Protestant movement because it had too much influence in Europe. The kings of Europe came to the same conclusion as the Protestants and began to move away from the papacy. No longer would they take orders from the papacy, who insisted that they impose Roman Catholic canon law upon the citizenry. No longer would the kings of the earth pay the stipends to the Roman Catholic Church for the crops that they grew in the country. No longer would they pay taxes to the papacy. No longer would they allow the Pope to be their King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And they liberated themselves, or rather Christ liberated them from the Pope. All of a sudden they had possession of their own lands. All of a sudden they had the benefit of their own produce. They no longer had to pay their exorbitant taxes and stipends to the Roman Catholic Church. The people were free to read and understand the Bible and to come to the logical, scriptural, and prophetic truth. So the papacy had to deal with it because the papacy was left an orphan in the Vatican. No longer did people worship him. No longer did people obey him. And when he ordered people to be killed, they rose up in their defense. So how did they deal with it? Well, they simply said, well, if preterism silenced the dissent in the Roman Catholic Church, and futurism silenced the dissent within the Roman Catholic Church, then we'll start preaching it to the Protestants in their seminaries and their schools. And that's how preterism and futurism became the curriculum of the Protestant churches. No longer did they teach historicism. No longer did they teach that the history of the popes leaves no room for doubt who the Antichrist is. They had to either believe in preterism or futurism, because that's the only things that were taught in the seminaries and the Protestant schools and Protestant churches and universities. It began in the early 1800s to be taught in the Protestant churches. That very thing that silenced the dissent within the Roman Catholic Church throughout the history of the Roman Catholic Church was now the main course of education in the Protestant schools. So that's what Protestants believe today. They either believe preterism or they believe futurism. Exonerate the papacy, and it's all, and it's altogether it's history. And now we have the ecumenical movement to reunite all the Protestant churches back to the Roman Catholic Church. Now, the author is going to give us all the details about preterism and futurism, except that both preterism and futurism are the ancient teachings of the Roman Catholic Church within the Roman Catholic Church to silence the constant accusation from Roman Catholics that the papacy is the Antichrist. And since it worked to silence dissent within the church, then the same thing is being used to be taught to the Protestants. Okay, I'm sorry that was so lengthy, but it'll give you perfect understanding. It'll make the rest of this book more easier to understand. Go ahead, Yerk.
Well, Tom, your explanations can never be long enough because people are taught so many lies in this world that it is a blessing to hear the truth for once. And again, and again, and again. This is why we took it on us to read this book to the public. So I will just repeat this little last paragraph on preterism to get back into the reading. Preterism generally attempts to place the fulfillment of all prophecy at the fall of Jerusalem in 70 AD, yet some preterists look at the fulfillment when pagan Rome fell in 410 AD. That's the time when the dream from Daniel in chapter 2, with that figure that consisted of a head of gold and arms of silver and thighs of brass and legs of iron, fell into the 10 toes, the 10 kingdoms that came out of the splintered Roman Empire, Roman pagan empire. Most preterists are of the post-millennial school and believe the called out ones will eventually, through teaching of the gospel and power of the Holy Spirit, convert the whole world to Christianity. That's what they are doing right now with the so-called ecumenical movement. But because that process could take 100, 1,000, or even 5,000 years, no miscalculations are possible, because that's left to our imagination how long that will take. That the power of the quote-unquote Holy Spirit, because that's not the Holy Spirit of the Bible, that's the quote-unquote Holy Spirit that is invoked by the papacy, which is another spirit, works for the conversion of the whole world to Christianity. That is ecumenism. That is the ecumenical movement that started with Vatican II in 1962, from 1965. Futurism places events prophesied in chapter 4 of the Apocalypse, or Revelation, through chapter 19 of the book, in the future, at the end of the Christian era. This is futurism. Everything contained from chapters 4 through 19 of the book of Revelation is placed into the future at the end of the Christian era. The term futurism is often found as a part of the longer title Dispensational Pre-Tribulation Rapture Futurist. One may use any of the individual designations to refer to the whole, which is often done. By their own words, it is evident that most futurists are pre-tribulation rapturists, and most rapturists are futurists. Both share their belief in dispensationalism. Now, this booklet focuses on the prophetic question of futurism, not on the pre-trib rapture issue, because many others have adequately covered that study. Mr. Dave McPherson has done excellent work in researching that question, and his books are readily available. Now the question is, where are we today? Even in 2017. This book, by the way, has been published in 2006, so it's for the moment just 11 years old. Where are we today is almost at the same time then. For the past 50 or 60 years, Christian bookstores have carried the usual Bibles and books on Christian living. However, for the most part, their Bible study themes and their books concerning prophecy were of the dispensational, the pre-tribulation rapture futurist point of view. This was the popular view during that time because, as history will substantiate, the high watermark of the futurist teaching was reached during the first half of the 20th century. During that era, many events came to pass that seemed to add credence to their theory. I just want to mention here also the Mary apparitions from 1917, if I'm not mistaken, that was.
Yes, but, and I'd like to add something here, too.
Yeah, please.
What the author is about to describe to you is something that prior to reading this book, I wasn't quite aware of. And that is that the futurist school of interpretation views the establishment of the nation state of Israel in 1948 as the beginning of the end times, the rise of the Antichrist, and the rapture, and all of that. Mm-hmm. And that it's already been, 70 years almost? Since the establishment of the nation state of Israel.
And that's why 2018 will be very interesting, Tom, because then it is 70 years. And you know the number 7 in biblical terms is a very important number. 7 is the perfect number of God. 70, you have Daniel's 70 weeks prophecy, of which futurists of call deny that the 70th week has been fulfilled. It would be quite interesting to see what happened 70 years after the founding of the nation state of Israel in 1948 in 2018, next year. Absolutely.
That's right. And the futurists have been expecting a huge increase in the fulfillment of certain Bible prophecies that have not since transpired. And so they're becoming doubtful of their futurist leanings. Is futurism correct? That's what they've been taught all their lives, just as I was. Futurism. From cradle to grave, I've been taught in a future fulfillment of all these prophecies. And the starting date for the fulfillment of those prophecies is believed by many futurists to be 1948, at the establishment of the nation state of Israel. And these prophecies have not since been fulfilled. So they're beginning to question now the futurist interpretation of Bible prophecy. And that's why it's appropriate for us now to discuss that school of Bible interpretation that was believed by all centuries of Christians, all the way from the Thessalonians under Paul's ministry up until the present. And that is the historicist interpretation of Bible prophecy. Preterists are lost in a delusion, thinking that we now live in the kingdom of Christ under the popes, and that the papacy is going to Christianize the whole world and evangelize the whole world. Futurists are holding out hope for a future fulfillment of those Bible prophecies, and they're becoming disillusioned. And so now is the appropriate time to bring out what has been believed by true Bible believers ever since Paul. Historicism, the historical interpretation of Bible prophecy. And as we continue and people come to grips with the true, the correct interpretation, the correct school of Bible interpretation, they're going to find out what consequences futurism and preterism have resulted in for the called out ones. Okay? Mm-hmm. Persecution, like you wouldn't believe. All right. You were beginning in the second full paragraph here on page 3 then.
Yes, I'm about to do that now. In 1897, the author continues, as a starting point, Mr. Theodor Herzl, who was, of course, as you probably know, Jesuit-controlled, organized the World Zionist Movement. The Schofield Reference Bible was published in 1907. November 1917, the famous Balfour Declaration pledged the British government to the establishment of a Jewish national home in Palestine. On December 11th, 1917, British forces took Palestine, including Jerusalem, from the Turks. From the 1930s and the rise of Benito Mussolini, many potential antichrists have arisen. In 1948, the United Nations partitioned Palestine, forming the Israeli state. And the Six-Day War of 1967 gave Israeli forces the capital city of Jerusalem. However, these events did not bring about the anticipated rapture.
Now, we could spend a week talking about this particular paragraph.
Yes.
I'm not going to talk a week about it. But you were right in suggesting that Theodore Herzl was Jesuit-controlled. Theodore Herzl was a Jew, and he was a leader of a sect of the Jews in Europe who desired, principally as a result of the persecution of the Jews during the Second World War and Nazi Germany, that the Jews deserved their own homeland.
That the world. This is before this. Tom, don't mix it up here.
Pardon?
The Zionist movement started in the end of the 19th century. The persecution by the Holocaust during the Second World War was 40 years after that. So,
yes,
they already planned that because they said that the Jews have to have a nation state, and they wanted to put them in there. Yeah.
Okay.
But this has nothing to do with the persecution that came. They used the persecution of the Holocaust and all that stuff, of course, because most Jews were not willing to go to Palestine, because they were living peacefully in countries like Germany and all of the rest of Europe. And you said that in another broadcast when God brought them out of Egypt, the Israelites brought them out of Egypt. He led them by their hand. He led them by a cloud in the day and by fire in the night. And a lot of Jews at that time said, as long as God does not lead us out of Europe in the same way that he led us out of Egypt in the time of Moses, we will not go. And those voices had to be silenced. And for that silence, they used the Germans to foment the Holocaust, of which Adolf Hitler said, I'm doing the same thing than the Roman Catholic Church did for 1500 years, only more effective. And
But you said Theodore Herzl was Jesuit controlled, didn't you?
Yeah, he was.
Okay.
Theodore Herzl was Jesuit controlled. The whole Zionist movement is Jesuit controlled. All the things that I've just said, they planned long, long time in advance, Tom.
Okay, then I don't retract anything I said. Theodore Herzl organized, the Jesuit-controlled Theodore Herzl organized the World Zionist Movement.
Absolutely.
In other words, the Jesuits organized the World Zionist Movement.
Absolutely.
Okay, there had to be a motivation or something to empower this World Zionist Movement, didn't there?
Of course, the motivation is the replay of the 70th week of Daniel that has been fulfilled by our Lord 2,000 years ago.
That's right, but we're getting way above the heads of the people. We're getting way above the heads of the people. We have, you know, we have to take this. Why I say we could speak a month just on this paragraph alone.
That's true.
And Theodore Herzl was the beginning of this World Zionist Movement. And in order for the World Zionist Movement to get more power and momentum among the Jewish nations, there had to be Jewish persecution.
Yep.
And that followed in the First World War and in the Second World War.
That's true.
Okay, Theodore Herzl is the beginning of it. The Jesuits wanted to foment a world call for a new Jewish state. Mm-hmm. And you and I already know the purpose they intend to use that Jewish state. But before we get into that, we're laying the foundation for this movement for a new Jewish state. Okay, and it's not a movement of God. The Jews largely still reject Jesus as their Messiah. Okay, they've been brought to Israel by man, by a man, the man of sin, the son of perdition. Okay, Theodore Herzl was Jesuit controlled. He started the World Zionist Movement, and following that was 1917, the First World War. And then the official call for a new Jewish state, the Balfour Declaration. Lord Balfour called for a new Jewish state, a refuge for the persecuted Jewish people. Okay? And the government of Britain became the power behind forming that real estate that is known as the Nation of Israel today.
Yeah.
A place for the Jews to go. Now, Rome, the Vatican, who was in control of the kings of the earth, has an agenda for that Jewish state. And you and I both know what that is, and that's a refulfillment of Daniel's 70th week, which was fulfilled perfectly and completely by Jesus Christ 2,000 years ago. To put it simply for your listeners, a careful reading of Daniel chapter 9, verses 23 through 27, describes Jesus' ministry. He put an end of sin. He made reconciliation for iniquity. He caused the sacrifices and oblations to cease. Okay? That was Jesus' ministry, seven-year ministry. He was baptized, anointed. The Most Holy was anointed by John the Baptist in the River Jordan at the beginning of his ministry, the beginning of the 70th week. 3.5 years later, he caused the sacrifices and oblations to cease by giving up his own life and becoming the Lamb of God, washing us in his blood. Atoning sin, putting an end of sin. Okay, if the sin is atoned, it is cast as far as the east is from the west. He put an end to sin. Okay, So Daniel's prophecy was fulfilled 2,000 years ago, but the papacy doesn't like that fulfillment. The papacy teaches the futurist interpretation that says the 70th week of Daniel won't be fulfilled until the end. The whole purpose of that is to make the Pope the Messiah of this future 70th week. In denial that Jesus was the Messiah 2,000 years ago, the 70th week of Daniel is over 2,000 years ago. Okay, so in order to fulfill this futurist interpretation, which exonerates the papacy as the Antichrist and makes him the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, they have to have a do-over of Daniel's 70th week, but with a different Messiah. And they intend, the Roman Catholic Church intends for that to be the papacy. The end of the future 70th week of Daniel is the papacy becomes the legitimate fulfillment of Daniel's prophecy. That's the whole purpose of this. So it took a Jew, Theodor Herzl, under Jesuit control, to call for a world Zionist movement. It took the Schofield Reference Bible to convince the world that the papacy is not the Antichrist, but that the Antichrist is a future individual. And it took the Balfour Declaration by Lord Balfour to call for a nation state of Israel, a modern nation state of Israel. It took the British government to accomplish it for the papacy, and British forces conquered the UN, conquered Palestine, and then the United Nations gave the land to the Jews.
That's why it's so important to understand that in the end of this very First World War, the British Empire, together with the French, dissolved the Ottoman Empire, that before that was the rule in Palestine and the whole region over there. And they formed all the nation states that we see today, all the borders from Lebanon, Jordan, Israel, Syria, Iraq, all these borders have been drawn with the dissolving, and Turkey, with the dissolving of the Ottoman Empire at the end of the very First World War, which they absolutely needed to get control over that region, over so-called Palestine, to place the Jews in there so that they could fulfill their plan to rise up the nation-state of Israel in 1948.
Yeah. So, since futurism is the ancient teaching of the Roman Catholic Church, believed among and taught in the Roman Catholic churches to silence the dissent, to silence the protest, to silence the accusation that the Pope, the papacy is, was, and always will be the Antichrist, then the papacy has to dedicate itself to providing the world an alternative Antichrist. And they simply took the book of the book of Daniel's chapter 9, verse 23 through 27, and cast it all the way to the end of time to produce. Look, if the Antichrist is going to cause the sacrifices and oblations to cease, then there must be Jews making animal sacrifices.
There have to be sacrifices.
And they can't be making sacrifices in a land that's not theirs, in a temple that's not theirs. So there has to be a modern nation state of Israel, and there has to be a temple built on Temple Mount so that they can begin animal sacrifices. And the papacy's behind all this. Look, the papacy is trying to protect itself from the onus of being the Antichrist. That's the constant accusation that has come up all throughout history among Catholics and Protestants alike. When they read their Bible, they come to the only conclusion one can come to, that the papacy is, was, and always will be the Antichrist. The papacy has been fighting this tooth and nail throughout the entire history of the Roman Catholic Church. And to put a final end to it, Rome literally has to convincingly refulfill the 70th week of Daniel, according to her interpretation of it, making the Pope the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, making the Pope the Messiah. And we see the papacy, the Jesuit-controlled Theodore Herzl working in this direction. We see the Scofield Reference Bible working in this direction. Because the Scofield Reference Bible, in all of its commentaries by Cyrus Scofield, indicate that the Antichrist is not the Pope, it's a future individual.
Indicates futurism, yeah.
That's right, it's futurism. Everything, the Balfour Declaration, is just a necessary legal mandate for a nation state of Israel. Look, you can't refulfill convincingly a future fulfillment of Daniel's 70th week until there's a modern nation state of Israel with Jews living in the land who have a temple and animal sacrifices. This chapter touches on every element that was necessary to bring this about.
This little paragraph even, yeah.
This little paragraph lists everything in the cookie recipe.
Yeah.
If you eliminate one element, you can't make your chocolate chip cookie. Okay, I hate to use colloquial terms, but look, the cookie is the refulfillment of Daniel's prophecy. The purpose of it is to present to the world a different Christ, an anti-Christ, a false Christ. The whole idea and how the world ever was convinced that Daniel's prophecy, the 70th week, was not fully and completely fulfilled by Jesus Christ 2,000 years ago is an absolute mystery. Because the historicist interpretation of Bible prophecy has always recognized Jesus as the fulfillment of the 70th week of Daniel.
It doesn't even allow for another conclusion.
It doesn't allow for another conclusion. And so those of the historicist interpretation of Bible prophecy have long had their Antichrist. They have long suffered under Antichrist rule and reign. They have long been subject to the kings of the earth who persecute them in the name of the Pope. But the world doesn't believe any of that today. And I must tell you, I must remind your listeners that both preterism, futurism, were never heard about in the Protestant world until the early 1800s. What was believed before that was historicism, that Jesus was the fulfillment of Daniel's 70th week, and that the book of Revelation literally outlines the entire history of the persecutions of the popes against God's people, the entire church age. Look, the truth is far easier to believe. It makes far more sense than anything that the Vatican has come up with to shed its itself of the onus of being the Antichrist.
It's also far easier to understand, Tom.
And it took, and in order to, and in order to deceive the whole world into believing in a future fulfillment of Daniel's 70th week, it took no less than Theodore Herzl. It took no less than the World Zionist Movement. It took no less than the Scofield Reference Bible. It took no less than the Balfour Declaration. It took no less than the help from the Protestant British government that had been taken over by the Jesuits to establish this national homeland in Palestine. It took no less than the British forces to conquer all those who occupied that land. It took no more than the destruction of the Turks and the Ottoman Empire to accomplish this. It took no less than Benito Mussolini to help bring about the liberation of the popes. Okay? All of these things, it took no less than the United Nations itself to establish this modern nation state of Israel. You ask yourself, who does the United Nations answer to? It's obvious from this information, the United Nations answers to the Pope. Because it was the United Nations that gave instrument to the creation of the modern nation state of Israel. And it took no less than the Six-Day War to give the Israelites the capital city of Jerusalem. Look, unless they have control of Jerusalem and Temple Mount, no one can convincingly refulfill the 70th week of Daniel.
And they have had control over Jerusalem between 1967 and 1993, yep. Because then with the Oslo Accords,
yep.
Shimon Peres gave, yep, 60% of Jerusalem to the Vatican.
Yeah.
And this is history that everybody can know, that is researched by Barry Chalmers, who passed away last year, sadly enough, and who wrote this book, Bye Bye Gaza, and where you can read the secret accounts of that Shimon Peres transferred 60% of Jerusalem to the Pope. And this is even fulfilling Bible prophecy. Because we have to see that in the Bible, in the New Testament, it says in Luke 21, verse 24 from the King James Version, and they shall fall by the edge of the sword, the Jews, and shall be led away captive into all nations, and Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. So that means that the Gentiles are in control of Jerusalem.
Right.
That is maybe a little thorn in the eye of all the people who like to bash the Jews and, yeah, say, oh, it's the Jews who rule the world.
Yeah.
No, it is not. There were four kingdoms that Daniel saw in the vision of the dream of Nebuchadnezzar. Four kingdoms, which are all over the world, agreed to be understood as the kingdom of Babylon, the kingdom of Medo-Persia, the kingdom of Greece, and the kingdom of Rome. Pagan Rome, and then Holy Rome, as we can call it today, the Holy Roman Empire. There is no fifth kingdom. There is no Jewish kingdom. The Jews are just Ponzi's. They are willing servants of the papacy in very many cases, in cases like the Rothschilds and stuff like this. But as we can read in Luke 21:24, until the time of the Gentiles be fulfilled, Jerusalem will be trodden down by the Gentiles, not by the Jews. So the Jews conquered in 1967 with the Six-Day War Jerusalem, but who was giving them the power to conquer that? Who was giving them the weapons for that war? The Gentiles. They were just the Ponzi's. They did their work, and they are still doing their work. Bibi Netanyahu, who is a papal knight, And of course, Shimon Peres was a 33rd degree Freemason. When he gave in the Oslo Accords, the rule of Jerusalem, of 60% of the old city of Jerusalem, to the Pope. Comment, Tom?
Yes, I'd like to comment. One thing that your listeners need to be reminded or informed, we are not anti-Jewish.
No.
We are not anti-Semites. We love the Jewish people as Paul loved his Jewish people. The Apostle Paul gave instruction to the church, that is the true body of believers, to boast not against the Jews, to boast not against the branches.
We are to provoke the Jews to jealousy, Tom, and that's what we are doing.
That's right. We know that the only salvation for the Jew is Jesus, their Messiah. And we pray for them fervently every day that the Jews receive Jesus, because if they don't receive Jesus, they're going to receive a false Messiah that the papacy has prepared for them. The Jews, as we see it today in Jerusalem and in Israel, are just ignorant pawns on a papal stage. It has a papal conclusion, not a Jesus Christ conclusion. The refulfillment of Daniel's prophecy is to present to the Jews and to the world a false Christ. Jesus said in the scriptures, He said to the Jews, I came in my Father's name, and you received me not. But there's one coming after me who will come in his own name, and him you will receive. That's the papacy. It is of utmost importance for all true Bible-believing Christians to present Christ, Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the fulfillment of the 70th week of Daniel, to the Jew as his Messiah, as his sacrifice for sin, and bring them into the body of Christ, not to put them on a stage, set them up to receive the Antichrist as their Messiah. The papacy's agenda for Israel, the Gentile agenda for Israel, the modern nation state of Israel, is to present to the Jews a false Messiah, the papacy. And we sympathize with the Jews. They are no less deceived than are the futurists of Christendom, and are as are the preterists of Christendom. They need to know, as we know, we historicists, that the papacy is the Antichrist. The papacy is the false Messiah. The papacy is the fulfillment, the false fulfillment of a false future 70th week of Daniel. The papacy desires the utter destruction, spiritual destruction of the Jews, just like she desires the ultimate destruction of Protestants. All of this work in Israel, with the cooperation of its own leaders, many of whom are 33rd degree Freemasons controlled by the Jesuit order, are setting up the Jewish people for their ultimate rejection of Jesus Christ in their acceptance of the papacy as their Messiah. That's what this is all about. You see, I told you I could speak for weeks just on this one paragraph in this book. And already I fear that I've bored my listeners to death and painted myself as an anti-Semite, but I love the Jewish people more than I can even express. They brought us the oracles of God. We saw them fall repeatedly into idolatry and how God chastised them and bring them back to himself. And yet we find the Jewish, or rather the Gentile equivalents of those people doing the same thing, falling into idolatry, falling into the ecumenical movement to reunite with the Church of Idolatry, the Roman Catholic Church. We're in this together. We true believers in Jesus Christ and the Jews need to accept Jesus as our Messiah and forget the future fulfillment of Daniel's 70th week and accept that Jesus was the fulfillment of the 70th week of Daniel 2,000 years ago. That's the truth. That's the historicist truth. You see, there's great, great value in understanding the historicist interpretation of Bible prophecy. And there's great, great, unspeakable harm in believing futurism and preterism. If you believe in preterism or futurism, you are destined to believe a lie. You are destined to receive a false Christ. The papacy in conjunction with the kings of the earth, just like the Bible says, he reigneth over the kings of the earth, have set us all up to believe a lie, have set us all up to believe that the Pope is, as he has always claimed to be, the vicar of Christ on earth. That's what futurism is all about. That's what preterism is all about. Historicism is none about that. Historicism reveals the papacy's secret agenda in the world. Historicism is the only correct interpretation of Bible prophecy. In the historicist interpretation of Bible prophecy, you cannot be deceived. And it goes without saying. This is why the early Christians prayed for the longevity of the Caesars, prayed for the health and longevity of the Caesars, because they knew the great deception would follow. That's the truth, the historical truth. And if you're sitting in a Protestant church that calls itself Protestant and has no idea who the Antichrist is, you're not sitting in a Protestant church. You're sitting in a papal church. They may preach the gospel. They may preach about Jesus, but they're preparing you to receive the Pope as his vicar. If they teach futurism or they teach preterism, they have deceived you. There's no getting around it. The most dangerous place for a Bible-believing Christian today is in the churches. Look, I'm going to teach some common sense here. If Satan wishes the whole world to worship him or his vicar on the earth, where do you think Satan would most likely be able to deceive those who know the truth? In the churches, right? Where better for Satan to get a foothold than in the churches? The Bible says Satan is transformed into an angel of light. Listen carefully to what it says following. And therefore his ministers are transformed into angels of righteousness. They appear to you to be teaching the truth. Angels of righteousness, your ministers, right? But they're preaching a future fulfillment of Daniel's 70th week. And what is lying in store for them and you is a papal Christ. The Antichrist. You can't get more consequential than that. They couldn't deceive you if they didn't preach Jesus Christ. But in their preaching of Jesus Christ, they are literally preparing you to receive another. One who comes in his own name, not a name that God gave him, but that he gave himself, Vicar of Christ. And him you will receive, just like the Jew.
Thank you very much, Tom. And this is where we're going to cut this broadcast in two, end part one. And I will see you back next time with part two, when we are going to read and discuss the book, The Origin of Futurism and Preterism. Me, Jörg from Juggler66, and Tom Fress from Inquisition Update. Until next time, God bless you and bye-bye.